Uptown, baby. Uptown, baby. We get down, baby. Up on the crown, baby.
Uptown, baby. Uptown, baby. We get down, baby. Up on the crown, baby.
Now, if it wasn't for the Bronx, this rap probably never would be going on. So tell me where you from.
Uptown, baby. Uptown, baby. We get down, baby. Up on the crown, baby.
It does sound familiar, doesn't
yeah.
it?
In the corner of my eye, I saw you and Rudy.
I saw you and Rudy.
You were very high.
You were very high.
You were high.
You were high.
It was a crying
disgrace. Well, it starts out, the guy's talking about this girl that he's involved with, and she's sitting at a counter, and he describes her behavior and habits, and out of that you begin to see her character and their relationship. Self-explanatory.
This tune really does speak for itself in a way that daunting to the commentary.
Black Cow, an ice cream soda. They used to, we're confused about this actually. I thought it was a soda.
There seem to be regional variations on the formula, but it's
root beer and vanilla ice cream or
soft drink.
Something like that.
Frothy soft drink.
Very big in the soda fountains when we were kids. Like a gangster on the run.
You will stagger home.
You'll stagger homeward to your precious one.
I'm the one. Who must make
everything
right.
Let's make everything right.
Talk it out
till daylight. Chorus. Walter and I both grew up around the New York area. Walter's originally from Westchester, and then I moved out to Queens, but went to school in Manhattan. And I'm from New Jersey, maybe 20 minutes over the bridge. So, we both grew up in this area. So I think New York life is what we most know about.
Here's a solo by Victor, very good solo by Victor Feldman.
Live on the tracking day.
Answered an ad in the Village Voice that said, you know, must have jazz chops,
keyboard,
no hang-ups.
Right. Keyboard, keyboard and bass player needed for working, jazz rock combo.
Something like that.
You know, must have jazz chops.
No hang-ups. So we answered the ad and we called, and we went out to Hicksville, Long Island, which for us was quite a haul, you know, because we never left Manhattan. We went out, and we went in the basement, you know, it was like a kid with a basement band, and we liked some of the material. It was kind of early fusion-type material, before there was jazz fusion in a way.
You know, it's like when they're in the same room at the same time, they're just like one person with two brains, you know. So it's the highbrow intellectual humor, you know, you don't get any fart jokes or anything of the kind. And they can usually finish each other's sentences. Well, I first met them when I put an ad in the Village Voice because I had a band and we were looking for a bass player and a piano player, and they answered the ad, so they joined my band at first. And then one by one, we realized that there was deficiency in certain of the players that, that wasn't quite up to this. You know, we started playing their songs right away, and I immediately saw that these were great songs.
If truth be told, we kind of took over his band. We kind of...
We wrecked it. Towards the end of the first rehearsal.
Started throwing out the other guys, you know, and kept Denny sort of, you know. And that, in a way, was the core of the Steely Dan group. Later, because when we got a job out in L.A., we sent for Denny.
when we got to California, I don't know that we were nostalgic in a general sort of way for New York so much as we were nostalgic as writers for this milieu that we left behind. And we weren't finished writing songs with New York characters in them yet. So we kept doing that. And by the time we were finished, we had moved back to New York, at which point we immediately started writing lyrics about California.
A lot of our songs are about being homesick, I think, for New York. I've noticed that, actually. I guess it's just was our natural inclination to write these sort of stories, really. Home at Last, the central metaphor was taken from Ulysses' big problem, you know, trying to get back home, but we didn't take it that seriously. It's essentially just the idea of it, and how do you write a little blues about Ulysses, you know? Here's a guitar riff, sort of a Chicago blues sort of item. Larry Carlton.
Donald and Walter love sophisticated harmony, but they're rock and roll guys. We're contemporaries as far as age, so we all were brought up listening to the 60s. And I know that they love rock and roll, but they also have a passion for harmony, which, as do I. All the players they use, we love great feeling rock and roll music, but we love harmony.
When we did Pretzel Logic, it was the first album we did with studio players. We had done a couple albums with our little band, and we had, you know, heard these players and done overdubs and stuff with them. But I found myself in the room with these guys, and I thought, like, wow, I'm really outclassed here, you know?
Aretha Franklin.
Nina Simone. Roberta Flack, Donny Hathaway. James Brown. Lloyd Price. Ray Charles, Frank Sinatra, Hines and Ford, Barry Manilow, Dionne Warwick, The Animals, The Monkees, The Beatles, B.B. King, Bobby Blue. Now, they already told me that they didn't want a shuffle. They didn't want the Motown. They didn't want the Chicago. But they weren't sure how and what they wanted, but they did want halftime. I said, fine, then let me do the Purdie Shuffle. And they said, well, what is that? I said, well, I'll show you where you can feel comfortable with it, and you'll end up getting exactly what you asked for. Halftime, funky, laid back, without thinking that it's a shuffle. And it goes something like this.
Let's isolate Bernard for a second, because let's listen to that beat.
Bernard, you know,
this isn't easy.
You'd come in with a tune and have sort of something in mind, but the way Bernard played stuff was always, he always had some unique stylistic thing that he did that you would never imagine in advance and that nobody else would do. This tune was good example of that. A lot of Bernard's hi-hat in this tune particularly is a real driving kind of.
You got the backbeat, you got double time, and you have it almost shuffle. Ooh, bee, rappa, rocka, ba, booka, da, booka, da, 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 da. Ooh.
Bernard, you know, this is the famous story where he, you know, he would come to a session, at, you know, in the early '60s, and he'd have two signs with him, and he'd set up these signs. One on one side of the drums would say, "You done it," and then the sign on the other side would say, "You done hired the hit maker, Bernard Pretty Purdy." So it's that kind of confidence that you need, you know,
yeah,
to get a good R&B track, you know. Ooh, ah, ooh, ah.